Okay, to wrap the keynotes up, we'll be talking about the current state and the foreseeable future of Qt from more from the product and technical side. And to do that, who else but our own Chief Maintainer of Qt and CTO of Qt Company, Lars Noll. Right.
Put your hands together for Lars Knoll, the Qt Company.
Thank you, everybody, and good morning. And welcome to the final keynote of this event. It's my pleasure to have that one once again. Today, I'll talk a little bit about different things. First of all, I thought I'll go in and have a little look at design principles that we've been using to develop the Qt libraries, the frameworks, and our tooling. What's important, really, for us when we develop and move Qt forward? And then, you know, look a little bit at what our focus areas are in R&D. What are we working on right now these days? What's important for us moving forward? And what do I see coming also a little bit more for the long term? So, let's get started. What we're seeing is that a lot of code, you know, is written once, but it's read and modified many, many times. You know, you don't write a code just, you know, as one thing. You put it somewhere and you throw it away. Usually you go in, even if you have an application that you need to maintain, you need to get out new versions of that application. And I think all of us, we know the feeling that we've been doing something, developing something, and then, you know, 2 years later, you come back to that code, you have no idea what you've written there. We've all encountered that. Or you have to go in and debug somebody else's code, even worse. So it's important that code really is that we know and acknowledge the fact that it's read a lot of times, and it has to be easy to do that. We also know that developers rarely comment their code. I'm very bad at that. I insert a comment when I really, really have to, but I try to somehow, you know, avoid it, or often I forget doing it. So also that makes it really, really important that code stays readable and maintainable. And it often lives also a lot, lot longer than we originally expected or planned for. You know, the world's banking systems is still run, you know, to a large extent on code that was written in the 70s. On these kind of machines that you see up there. Nowadays, they moved it over into something else. But the code is still there and it's still being used. Same with code, you know, even inside Qt. Qt is now the framework, it's a bit over 20 years old. There are still some areas in there that has actually, you know, have been untouched for all of these 20 years. Or only very slightly modified. So what does that mean for what we're doing and how we're developing our APIs? We need APIs that lead to maintainable and readable code. They have to be intuitive, self-documenting, and they have to make it easy and natural to write correct code. That's something that we've been putting a lot of effort into when we've developed Qt, when we're developing our APIs. I was going in and seeing that we have descriptive naming. We have done a big move when we moved from Qt 3 to Qt 4 to move towards more property-based APIs to make that things readable so that you don't have to decipher what it is, but you can just read, you know, okay, set text, set minimum, set maximum, so that you really see what the code is doing when you look at it at a first glance. Try to hide lots of the complexity in our implementations and really don't expose it to you as users. And one of the things that we've also been always doing and working towards, signals and slots are, for example, one mechanism that does that is really to remove the need for boilerplate code as much as possible. Boilerplate code is always something that every one of us hates writing, you know. Have to write that thing again? I've done that somewhere else as well, and now it's just the same thing, slightly modified. You don't want to do that over and over again. It's just work that, you know, gets in your way, something that you later on have to search through, read, and you don't want to do that. You want to write logic, not boilerplate. APIs really should be easy to learn and use and hard to misuse. A class should implement usually one concept or a method, one concept, one thing. In the end, still, it should lead to that you are able to do a lot with that one class without having to, you know, learn a lot about it. The namings should be consistent and descriptive. So, for example, if you move between, you know, one class and another one, you know, similar concepts should lead to the same name. Simple and clear semantics are important. You know, the defaults that are there should match what you intuitively expect as a user. We want to encourage good programming practices. For example, don't fail if the methods are called in a different order. Don't have subtle or hidden side effects. You know, one thing that we have been trying hard to avoid now is implicit conversions, even though C++ as a standard has some of that built in. I wish it hadn't, but it does. But let's at least try to do that as little as possible. And we've had our failures here as well. I mean, for example, good example is QVariant, which does implicit conversions. One of the things I really dislike and that I would like to fix at some point. And let's not do magic. That's also one of the things here. Let's not have a set text method that implicitly checks, is this maybe HTML, and then we'll display it as HTML. Sometimes you have tags, and then you do want to display it as plain text. And finally, also, you know, making sure that we really have very good documentation. Another important aspect, performance. This is one of the things that's been interesting. I've been at CppCon just 2 weeks ago, and one of the things that, you know, is important for the CPP standardization committee and the people working there is a principle that they have, that you don't pay for what you don't use. Meaning, you know, whenever you use some part of the framework, you shouldn't pay for anything else. Ultimate performance, in a way. In Qt, we've modified that slightly. We want to have good performance on all parts of the framework, but it's also important that we don't complicate the default API for performance reasons. And the reason for that is that, you know, in many ways, another, you know, a different way of looking at performance is also, how fast can I get my app developed? How quickly can I get it to market? That requires some easy APIs. And most of the code you're writing is not performance sensitive. You know, there's a small part, you know, some inner loops. Those have to fly. Everything else is usually fine. So, easier APIs are very important in that respect, easier APIs. And, you know, in many cases, these goals don't conflict at all. But, you know, we need to go as much as possible the extra mile to create the API that's performant and simple. And when that is not 100% possible, you know, give you guys some low-level access to optimize the critical paths. APIs should be flexible. And that means, for me, that they cover the 90% use case and make that one very, very simple as we can make it. But they need to be extensible as well. There are use cases that go beyond what the API provides out of the box. And that 10%, should be the 10% use case. So 90% is something we want to cover with our APIs out of the box. The remaining 10% is something that we want to enable and have to be possible. It means you have to write a little bit of code of your own, but you can do it. As said, keeping it simple is important. We have a lot of, you know, people coming to C++ through Qt. Qt is actually the place where they start going into C++, and we need to have a low barrier of entry. C++ is a complex language. There's lots of, you know, very complex constructs in there. I mean, all of you who have done a little bit of template metaprogramming or looked at that code know what I'm talking about. It's really hard to read and hard to write. But it doesn't have to be that way for most of your daily work. You know, most of the projects that I'm seeing don't have only C++ gurus. They can They have some engineers there, maybe also that didn't study computer science, studied some other engineering thing, and they want to get the things done. So most of the complexity in C++ is required only rarely. It's good to have there, you know, it's good to have those tools at hand when you need them, but you usually don't need them. So you can make 99% of the code self-explaining and easy to write. That's what we're aiming for. Another piece that's important for us is stability of our APIs. We've been, you know, within, you know, major versions, we're always keeping source and binary compatibility, meaning should be easy for you to upgrade from one version of Qt to the next, and don't have to worry about that anything in your app breaks. That's what we're trying to do. Sometimes fail at it a little bit, but we're getting pretty good at that. Also, when we move from one major version to next one, and you know that has been the last time for Qt 4 to Qt 5, and I'm currently not knowing when that will be the next time, but when that should ever happen, of course we want to minimize any breaks there, make sure that you can basically move very easily between those versions. And the way to do that is also to make those APIs as good as possible in the first place. Have a very, you know, conscious process where we do API reviews. We put most of our new APIs or new modules that we have often into a technology preview status at the beginning. Letting you test them out, give us feedback. And only once we have gotten a couple of rounds of feedback, we will really, you know, commit to them, say, okay, now they're stable. So that's on the API side. There's another piece that's really, really important, and that's the tools. Tooling is becoming more and more important as we move along. And tooling has to cover all parts of the development process. You know, from, you know, the initial design, you know, graphical designers working with their own tools, how do I get that integrated into the project, you know, to the development process, you know, packaging, deployment, and then maintenance. Just very important. How do I, you know, take that code I've released version one now, in a couple months later I want to release, you know, an updated bug fix version or a new feature release. How do I do all of that? This is something we need to work on, and there's still a lot of work there to make that easier, simplify things, also automate common tasks so that you don't have to worry about that. Another thing, area that I believe is good is if we can give immediate feedback. We've been doing that, for example, in the latest version of Qt Creator. If you enable the Clang code model, you can see immediate feedback on, you know, on compiler warnings and compiler errors on the right-hand side, you know, embedded into your source code. We give that feedback immediately. Similar for graphical editors, when you want to graphically edit your user interface, should be able to get some immediate feedback there to see how it looks, how it feels and behaves. You know, and the final thing also, you know, tailoring the app to specific use cases, and I'll come back to that a little bit in a minute. And with that, you know, move forward, you know, continue to evolve Qt Creator, new versions of C++, whatever's coming in, make sure that we also cover those kind of things. Okay, let's move a little bit over from design principles to a little bit to looking at what are we focusing on in R&D these days? What's happening? What's going on? One big area is actually graphics. There's a lot of things ongoing over the last couple of years. New graphics APIs having been introduced with first, you know, with Metal from Apple, with Vulkan, with Direct3D 12 from Microsoft, all of those, you know, being there as, you know, something that could be used instead of OpenGL for low-level things. How do we deal with that? If we're having now, again, a place where, you know, a cross-platform toolkit might be able to help. We have lots of different APIs. Can we unify that and bring you to use something that you can use on top of all of these APIs in a good way? So, as said, we have those APIs. Can we do something to unify those behind one, for example, in the Qt Quick case, one scene graph. And we've been doing work on that one right now, and this is something that's actually very much in the works. I can show you a little bit on what's happened now with Qt 5.9. we have on Qt Quick no hard dependency on OpenGL anymore. And we've started supporting different backends there. We have OpenGL, we have OpenVG, we have for a little bit longer already a software rasterization. We've done some experimental support for Direct3D 12. So we're trying to encapsulate that problem and of having different graphics APIs and not expose it to you so you can directly work on top of that. In 5.10, we will have more things. We have some cross-platform enablers or some for Vulkan coming, you know, QVulkan instance, QVulkan window, and doing more works in this area. So that's one path. Another area in graphics is actually the tooling side of things. Qt didn't really have any 3D tooling for the longest time, up until now. We're now working, and you can see downstairs also demos and some talks about Qt 3D Studio. It's a new 3D UI design tool. This actually originates from NVIDIA, who had been using that as NVIDIA Drive design and coming from there, and they contributed all of that to Qt. It's a designer-friendly tool, designer-oriented. The tool is, we're developing this now. We've been getting the contribution early in, you know, late winter, early spring, and haven't been showing it out to the world too much yet because we had to do some work to prepare everything. But it is now, since end of last week, we have the source code available out on qtproject.org. You can download it, you can play with yourself, you can contribute to it, and it's licensed under the GPL and commercial licenses. We're working also, and this is more, you know, stuff that's coming, you know, in the future, hopefully some of this already for 5.11, on, you know, how do we work with graphical assets? You know, when we look at Qt 3D Studio, you can already import tools from other graphical assets from other tools like from Maya or from Photoshop. Want to generalize that, make sure that we can import assets that you're using in your application from, you know, other tools, from the tools that UI designers, for example, use, and bring that into your Qt-based project. Then as a next step, we want to, you know, make sure that we have a conditioning pipeline there, something where you can then where we can, during build time, optimize all of those assets for a specified target operating system and hardware. For example, if you have lots of PNGs, you know, might want to put them into a texture atlas and convert that, you know, atlas that contains all of those PNGs then into a complex texture format like ETC2. And then, you know, embed that into the deployed application bundle in some way or another. Either, you know, as, for example, queue resources into the application itself, or bundle it together with the application. Make that easy for you. And we have some stuff there coming also, you know, in the next release where we, for example, have now ETC 1 and 2 compressed texture support already enabled in Qt Quick for 5.10. So we're working on putting this together within the next couple of releases. Another big work area of work is, you know, creating a unified graphics pipeline for Qt. There's been lots of work ongoing, you know, a lot of it thanks to our partner KDAP on Qt 3D, and that will form, you know, a lot of the basis for our 3D story moving forward. Currently, Qt 3D Studio, because we inherited from NVIDIA, is using a separate 3D runtime for running whatever you created in 3D Studio. And we're now working on unifying that by moving that runtime on top of Qt 3D. So we'll have one consistent story there, one consistent way of doing this, and it'll make it much easier for you then also to extend the Qt 3D Studio runtime with other things. Also need to think about how we integrate, you know, the 2D side of things, i.e. Qt Quick user interface into this. Looking also, you know, for 3D Studio, once it's based on Qt 3D, we also have the integration into the widgets space. And then looking forward also, you know, what do we do with AR and VR support, enable that one fully into the tool chain. And as another idea then on the designer side, you know, how do you design things? We need to unify that experience between Qt 3D Studio and the Qt Quick Designer. Bring that together, share workflows, have a cross integration, and hopefully in the long term, one tool for it all. So that's one big work area. Another one, just working on our essential libraries. You know, this is ongoing maintenance, improvements, development that's going on there. You know, things like, you know, introducing work that introducing things like QStringView, that's been a contribution from KDAB, QRandom generator, real random numbers, done by Tiago from Intel, QFloat 16, endianness dependent integers that we've been doing. So lots of different things there, and then, you know, also lots of things in some of the other base libraries around it. So Qt QML, we, for example, now introduced a new caching infrastructure that in the long term will replace the commercial Qt Quick compiler. We've also, you know, working now towards a simplified infrastructure on how we compile Qt QML down to native code, where we've been working on a new bytecode interpreter as the first stage. So move from native from QML to a bytecode, and then only JIT optimize that one. We've already seen good progress there because the new bytecode generator is almost as fast as our current JIT. So once we then, you know, add the JIT on top, we hope that we can beat what we have currently by a good margin. This is going to come, a good part of that is going to come for 5.11. In Qt Quick, you know, we now have shapes support. You can draw vector paths in Qt Quick and easily do that. That's coming for 5.10. We have pointer handlers, big item where we, you know, really are rethinking how you do handle and interact with input. You know, how do we interact with touch and mouse events, bring them into Qt Quick and as a technology and make that much easier and more intuitive to work with. Been expanding the Qt Quick controls, you know, making Qt Quick controls to work on the desktop in a better way, have some new animation effects, multi-touch support for buttons and sliders, for example. There's a lot of new controls coming in, like dialogues, many dialogues, system tray supports, action and menus, a fusion style for desktop, and we have an image-based style that allows you to easily implement your own custom look and feel. Very important these days, you know, everybody's talking about the Internet of Things, but, you know, connectivity in general is the basis of all of that. How do different, you know, machines, computers, applications talk to each other? And that's a big focus area for us to make sure that we support whatever is required there. So we've added now support for HTTP strict transport security, network authentication with OAuth. We have, you know, work in progress on Qt remote objects, a contribution that's coming from Ford originally. We have Canon Modbus support now, KNX, MQTT as protocols, and we're working on extending that, for example, to OPC UA and other new protocols. Another thing that's really important to us is actually something that I think we've been, you know, putting a little bit on the back burner in the last years. We're trying to, you know, get a bit back to making sure that, you know, all of you who use it can be happy with it. That's Qt Widgets. Qt Widgets is something that, you know, we had so many things to do, you know, bring Qt to to the mobile operating systems, work on the embedded things. So it's been, you know, in a state where we've been, yeah, fixing the most important things, but not too much. KDAB has been maintaining that for a couple of years, so thanks a lot to them for that. But now we have been taking this over in the Qt company, and we're putting a bit more resources on making sure that we bring this forward. First focus here is, of course, on fixing, you know, outstanding bugs, completing some functionality, filling API gaps, and keeping up with whatever's happening on the underlying desktop, mainly desktop platforms. But we'd also be interested in hearing a little bit from you. If you have that, you know, give us your feedback. What kind of new functionality would you actually want to have in widgets? What do you require? Let us know, and we'll see how we can prioritize that in the future. Let's have a quick look at device creation, what's happening in that area. Also there, things are important to look at the whole lifetime of the application. What we're seeing, one of the things we're seeing where we had a lot of requirements is how to work with devices that need to be in one way or another certified for safety requirements. I've been working on that. People want to create user interfaces for certified devices, whether that's in the automotive space, medical space, you know, or many other, anything related to transport, anything related to medical, and many other areas require that kind of functionality. So we've been working on what we call Qt Safe Renderer, which is something that allows you to control and render safety-critical UI elements. So you separate the safety-critical parts of your user interface into something that can be rendered by the Safe Renderer. Everything else, you have still full flexibility into your UI design, and you can integrate that with the Qt Quick Designer. And with that, you know, then relatively easy get to a Qt-based system that you can also use in safety-critical systems can get certified. Architecture looks a little bit like that, that, you know, we separate the safe user interface into a separate process, often running in a separate, you know, under a certified hypervisor in a certified operating system. So make that, you know, fully safe. And then the main UI can run either as a separate process, also on the certified operating system, or in a separate, you know, separate partition on a standard, for example, Linux operating system or whatever you choose. The content goes into different hardware layers, and the safety critical one is always the one on top. And those are composed then, you know, by the hardware, by the display hardware, down to bring things onto the screen. And there's a little bit of a control mechanism, so the safe render controls the main user interface, which sends a regular heartbeat back telling the safe render, well, I'm still alive and running. And with that, the safe render can then also, you know, if something should go wrong, restart the main user interface. That's one thing. Another thing we've been seeing is on many embedded devices, you might have a headless device, no screen attached to it, but you still want to have the possibility maybe to use Qt to do a user interface on that device. And then, you know, whenever I come near that device, for example, with my tablet or with my phone, you know, I can show the user interface on the tablet and the phone. That's something we've been implementing now with what we call WebGL streaming, where you have a Qt application. And that Qt application, you know, can run a specialized Qt platform plugin that basically allows you to stream all the user interface over through WebGL into a browser on the other side. User input gets streamed back, and you have a very nice, you know, way of doing those kind of headless applications where you don't really need any user interface attached to it, and you still get the full Qt experience. Another focus area for us has been performance. A lot of it, just improving it throughout different areas. And I'll show you a couple of examples there. So it's both about, you know, lowering, you know, memory consumption, you know, lowering the amount of the size of Qt. That has been a big focus. But then also, you know, just, you know, how many CPU or GPU cycles do you use when running your applications? Here's an example. What we've done now, we've added with Qt 5.9 an OpenGL shader cache. It caches compiled shaders on disk, and you see that this really improves, you know, the graphics initialization and thus application startup time by a large amount. Now, if you look at the numbers from 5.6 or 5.8 and compare that to 5.9, you'll see that we really cut down by almost 90%. Well, except for NVIDIA, who already had some caching implemented on their own. Been working on JavaScript and QML performance. Some numbers here comparing to what we had in 5.6 to what we now have in 5.9, and you see that we improved by 400% on ARM64. That's a really big number. On the other thing, the platforms, we improved by 120%. But as I told you earlier, we're working on some stuff now where I believe that with 5.11, maybe 5.12, we'll have, you know, another large step forward. And we've also done a lot of work there to reduce function call overhead, which makes QML bindings a lot faster. So we're already seeing a huge improvement in QML bindings that will come with 5.11. Qt Quick Controls, we had, you know, in 5.6, the Qt Quick Controls 1. We've been doing a lot of work now towards Qt Quick Controls 2, focusing really on the performance. And you see that here, how much they have improved between 1 and 2. So Qt Quick Controls 2 are a lot faster. And then just lately, you know, we've been looking a little bit into Qt 3D performance and, you know, optimizing that one. That's some work we've been just doing a couple of weeks ago, and looking at Qt 5.9 and, you know, improving the memory consumption, what we have in 5.9 and 5. You can see already memory consumption has dropped for simple examples by around 60 megabytes between 5.9 and 5.9.2. And I expect we can drop another 30 out of that by 5.9.3. We have the patches already, they just need to get integrated. CPU usage is also something where we have been working for different things. I mean, you see some examples here. Those are examples that we've been just using internally to test things. They're basically, some of them are Qt 3D Studio based with a new 3D runtime that we're working on. And you see that we're also there. We're managing to get good improvements, and we have a lot more coming in that way route. So you can already, you can still expect quite a bit of performance improvements there, actually, in the 5.9 series. Okay, let me talk a little bit about more things that are a bit further out. What are the big ticket items that I'm seeing where we want to do, where we're doing research on, where we say, you know, this is something we need to, you know, have an answer to in the future, whatever that answer is. The first one, digital assistance, voice control. As you heard earlier this morning, this is going to become very important. You know, people will want at some point to control many of their apps with voice. I've done a little bit of pre-work right now. We have Qt Speech now, which does text-to-speech, so the computer can answer. But we need to do more work to figure out how do we integrate that? How do we basically, you know, integrate voice control into the applications? And that puts a lot of, you know, different things, questions up, you know. How do you make the things context sensitive? So the, you know, the, whatever processes the voice control knows, or the voice gets the voice input, knows, you know, what the context is from the application. What kind of things will the user say in that context? How do I react to that? So it's a multimodality problem, because users might also go in and say something and then still, you know, hit some buttons at the same time. How do I work, and how do those interactions work? So this is a larger research area, but I think it's going to be very important. And then also thinking about how do we integrate with different, you know, assistive technologies that are out there. You know, there are already a couple of them out there, Alexa, Cortana, Siri. Can we integrate with those? What can we do on our own? We'll have to figure that out. Second big item, artificial intelligence. You know, this is a big topic coming now, and people are using those kind of algorithms and deep learning more and more to do, to get certain tasks done. You know, our GPUs are getting, you know, extremely powerful, and we can do a lot of those kind of things already on, you know, on the PC that you're using, on the phone that you're using, or on the embedded device you're using. So what can we do there? What kind of solutions can we offer? What kind, is this mainly an integration exercise? You know, can integrate with TensorFlow and similar APIs, or are there other things we want to offer out of the box? And then, of course, you know, how do we integrate with the cloud in a better way? We've already doing lots of work there with the connectivity, you know, enabling different protocols for machine-to-machine communication. Are there more high-level APIs that we also should be offering? And abstract those away from, you know, the cloud provider that you're using. So storage, for example, communication protocols, different computations that you can do in the cloud, some services like image face recognition, digital assistance, voice recognition, I already talked about. So we need to offer easy integration points with those APIs, and we've still, you know, as Qt is, you know, a cross-platform framework, also here, you know, it's important that we then also keep this independent of the cloud, of a specific cloud provider. Let's see how we can do that. That's a lot of work, and we don't have many of the answers we don't have yet, but we will be working on those things throughout the years to come, to really, you know, have hopefully more things for you there in the future. Okay, let me finish off with a short view at our release roadmap. what are we having? We've released 5.9.2, 5.6.3 actually, a little bit earlier, this couple of weeks ago, 5.9.2 just last week on Friday. We've released the 5.10 beta now a couple of days ago on Monday. We're expecting, you know, another couple of, you know, good releases on the 5.9 series. They will, as time progresses, get, you know, a bit more spaced out, but for the moment we're trying to still get out quite a lot of them, let's say every 1 or 2 months. 5.9, as you know, is a long-term supported release. So we'll have that for 3 years, commercial support and everything. And, you know, as always, you can, of course, also buy extended support for any release from the Qt company afterwards. 5.10 and 5.11 will be standard releases with standard supports. We expect 5.10 to be out in November. 5.11 at sometime in spring. And then we'll have, that's as far as our planning horizon currently goes. We will have a 5.12 release, you know, next year, autumn. So when we hopefully meet again next year, I'll hopefully have quite a bit to tell about 5.12. And there's a chance that 5.12 will then be, you know, the next long-term supported release that we're doing. We currently have 5.6 long-term supported, 5.9. And let's see if that becomes a regular rhythm that we'll have that every three minor releases. I'm not sure about that yet, but we'll see how things evolve. And with that, I'd like to thank you very much for your attention. Hope you enjoyed the show and hope you'll enjoy the rest of the session.